ask for approval of the new agenda.
I make a motion we approve the agenda.
Second.
All in favor? Motion carries. Thank you. Old business, general budget process. Joe?
Okay, before I get started, I'd like to recognize Lisa. She's got an introduction she'd like to make.
Okay.
I wanted to introduce Adora Thayer. She is our intern that'll be with us for the next 3 months. If you'll stand, Adora, so that they can recognize your face, and if you'll take the time to speak to her, it would be really good. She's going to do a lot with us in all of our different departments to get to know what we're doing and kind of figure out what direction she wants to go in the MPA program.
Welcome.
Welcome.
Okay, as far as an overview of what we're going to talk about tonight, let me give some broader context about why we set up the meetings the way we did. This work session tonight and the work session on the 27th is meant to give you the opportunity to ask all of us not only the details of what's in your budget, but also the rationale behind that budget. Our intent is, or was, it's really up to you all, but our intent was to then take forward the budget that we presented to you last week and have that be the basis of your public hearing on the 6th. So on the 6th, you will have had two meetings to look into the details of the budget, to understand the rationale of the budget, but also to hear your community's comments on the budget at a public hearing. And then after the public hearing, you can make the decision whether you want to approve that budget or if you want more time with the budget and roll it into a work session. So that's one option forward, and that's the reason we set the dates up the way that we did. You don't have to go that route. Another route you can go is at the second work session, if you want to start changing the budget and then present a different budget for your public hearing on the 6th, you can do that. One thing, if you do that, that I ask of you is we need to be really clear on what kind of changes you want to make. And so it helps us if you all can make a motion and vote on that, so we can be real clear that all of you all understand what changes are being made, and so that we're clear not only on the changes that you are requesting, but also that it reflects a majority of what you all want. So a couple of directions, but the intent of the meetings that we set up was that you could go to the public hearing on the 6th with the one that we presented, but you don't have to go that route. That can be your call on the 27th. As far as what we're gonna—
Let me jump in real quick, if I may. First of all, Don has informed me that he is not available for the 24th, so we need to move that. I would like to have a full board here for that meeting, so I would propose that we move it to the 18th, which is on a Wednesday, unless y'all have something else, but I really would like everyone to be here for these meetings. So, does anyone have any problems with that?
Is that next week?
Everybody okay?
What was the other day? The 20 what?
24.
Yeah, your schedule right now for the 24th.
Already scheduled. Yeah.
Budget 17.
Yeah. So I just picked the 18th because.
is that enough time? Staff,
get all this stuff together. Well, yeah, where they're going to need time is after that. I'm of the opinion, if y'all aren't, that's fine, but I'm of the opinion that what we go to the public hearing with needs to be our budget so that the people can look at what we actually propose after we've had a chance to do any modifications that we may want to do to this one. But that would actually give them more time to do that.
Okay, that's fine.
If anybody disagrees with that, chime in. I don't know. Is that date okay with everyone? You make a motion.
I'll make a motion. We do it on the 18th rather than the 24th.
Okay. Did I hear a second?
Second.
Second. Okay. All in favor? Okay. Thank you. That's what I have.
As far as what we're going to talk about tonight is we're going to focus presentations on property management, greenways and sidewalks, and stormwater. And to connect back to the presentation that was made last week, the property management budget that we presented to you has associated with it a dedication of a 1/2 cent property tax increase towards this area. Similarly, for Greenway Sidewalks, the budget that we presented to you last week has a 1/2 cent property tax increase dedicated towards this effort. The stormwater, what we're proposing is right now you charge a stormwater fee. And what we have done in this budget is we've redirected that fee away from operations and put it towards capital projects. So when Chris is going through the funding for stormwater and you see the figure $108,000, that's our anticipated revenue from the fee, that the stormwater fee that you charge. So real quick, any questions on the things I talked about before I turn it over to Chris? Okay, seeing none, I recognize Chris Ray.
Thank you, Joe. Good evening, Mayor, members of the board. Tonight, we'd like to try to bring in front of you some more detail to the budget presentation that Joe did last week. We're going to try to concentrate on two areas that he said were main goals for this budget, which were manage our existing investments and do returns on investments. Clearly, property management is a big piece of that, managing our investments. We currently now are maintaining over 80,000 square feet of buildings and structures throughout town. And I say we, I mean Public Works, Parks and Rec, Fire Department. We're also maintaining over 108 acres of grounds throughout the town that are public right-of-ways, public properties, and et cetera. So clearly at times these can be challenging and difficult tasks for your staff. Couple of the guiding principles that as we laid out the CIP budget for you, and the objectives for us was, in regards to financing, was finance as little as possible. We want to pay as you go as much as you can. And we want to consider useful life. If we're going to finance something that's a large ticket item, we don't want to finance it for a period of time where when we finish making payments for it, the useful life is gone. So if it has a useful life of 5 years, we don't want to finance something for 5 years. We want to basically see that to be double of that. So when we're finished making payments on something, then we do have some time to breathe a little bit and relax before we have to look about replacing that item. Secondly, we want to look at recognizing some reserves. Several years back, I think in 2011, you set up a capital reserve for buildings. Currently, we have $38,000 in it. We'll be recognizing those revenues. Also, and I don't remember when this actually started, but it's a little bit before 2011, Five County Stadium, we set up a capital reserve for any improvements out there that we might be required to make. And we currently have about $155,000 in that reserve. We're also going to recognize some as a revenue source that some facility debt is going to be retired in 2019. That is the debt for the community center itself and the purchase and renovation of it. It's also the roof and wall and some ball field improvements we did at Parks and Rec for almost a $250,000. One of the other objectives we're trying to recognize is our partnership with Wake County to recognize some fire revenues.
Chris, can I stop you there?
Yes, sir.
I had totaled up debt retirement in 2019, and I know this says facility debt, but the total debt retiring is $370,000.
These were the two, the debt numbers that I'm using in for the center and also the ball fields and stuff.
I understand that. I'm just saying that the total debt retirement is $370,000 in 2019.
Okay, what was the third one, sir?
You've got
the center.
Community center, ball field lights, wall and roof at the community center, fuel system rehab, and vehicles and equipment.
Okay, that would be the vehicles and equipment, yes, sir. And when you see Tim's presentation next week on the vehicles and stuff, you'll see that show up in that.
I understand that. I'm just trying to make it clear, because I know that on the second one, something had to be pulled out, fuel system rehab probably, to hit this number.
Well, what actually happened is the number that you saw in Joe's book, when we finance those things, the financing is based on a flat principal amount, and then the interest decreases over the years. So when Joe showed you your debt service payment in this year's budget, that number is correct. And then as we move out several years, the number goes down slightly because the interest goes down because the balance is a little less.
But it's still considerably more than this.
Oh, yes, yes. But in regards to facilities and property management, this is
okay. I just wanted to make that clear.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Robin. Couple of items that we, that the staff had generated and needed to be looked at from a property management standpoint is the community center, the paint, the gym ceiling. Currently, if you look up closely, there's bar joists that are peeling. We noticed this starting in about the fall of 2014. The cost estimate for that, complete that work, is $22,000. The community park, we've got several requests over the years for at the rear parking lot to put some lighting in back there. We're proposing, if we fund this project, is to reuse some ball field, some basketball court poles that we salvaged from a previous project and put LED lights on that. That's estimated at $15,500. Your fire station has a 2-inch water line that needs to be replaced. That's the original 1974 galvanized line. And as y'all know from y'all days in water and sewer, galvanized lines have a limited useful life, and clearly we're at the we're past that at this point in time. The second item at the fire station is a delta high leg conversion. Basically, that's a three-phase service at that location. That's 120, 240. And what you see is on one of the legs that sometimes when you read it, well, all the time you read it, it's 140 volts. And what we would recommend is, from a compatibility standpoint, is to change that over to a true three-phase service that's 12208. And so that helps us with safety, make sure we, since the electronics don't get put on the high leg, we also can balance the load on the generator a little better. The cost of that is $17,625. The third item at the fire station is a fire alarm replacement. This is the existing fire alarm that's there is an original 1982 fire alarm system that was surplus by the Wake County Schools and was installed by a former assistant chief in the late 90s. Currently, that system is not working and needs to be replaced, and is a requirement to have that as part of NFPA 70 for sleeping quarters.
All right, let me ask you a question there. Are these at full price figures?
Full price?
That's, is this our 50% or is it
the full? That's the full price, sir.
Full price, okay.
Mm-hmm. The next item is Five County Stadium. As you're aware, we maintain the parking lot lights for 264 alternate parking lot and the 39 parking lot. There's a total of 84 fixtures out there. We're recommending converting them to LED for two reasons, savings on electrical bill and also for maintenance. The projected payback is 5 to 7 years on those, including taking into consideration maintenance. The next item we have is Highway 64 off-ramps. One of the things that's come up is the possibility about needing some wayfinding signage. We possibly could look at possibly putting four of these signs up. They're about $2,500 a piece. There's opportunity maybe even put them on the 97 off-ramps, but they include the full breakaway and fluted bases, and four of those is $10,000. Next facility that we want to look at is the Public Works facility. As you know, the Public Works facility is a little bit out there, is a little bit remote. It's times we have individuals there by themselves. We'd like to see a security system put in similar to what's done at the community center with four cameras and a panic button. That's estimated at $6,000. The next item at Public Works is automated gates. A good part of the safety and security for the Public Works facility is access control. I can't tell you how many times over the years that we have found people just walking our maintenance yard, in our buildings, coming in the backside of our buildings, and they basically say they're just looking for someone. And a couple times I felt like they are actually scoping us out. So we want to be able to control access in and out of our facility with automated gates, similar to what the public police department has. Next item at Public Works is we'd like to see a facility master planning and surveying done. Those two buildings were originally built in 1986 and 1987. They're getting close to 30 years old. We're needing to look for some renovations at the office and some expansion. Same way with a maintenance shop, maintenance yard, with some storage facilities. We feel like the best way to do that is plan that. Last thing we want to do is go out and build something and recognize that we need to then, oops, we should not have put it there. So we want to master plan that site. As you know, we have some extra land that goes down toward the railroad track into the recycling center. Come up with a master plan for the stormwater improvements there, and then come back in future years and try to address those items that are generated from the facility master plan. The next item is the town hall. Over the years, we've made significant improvements to Town Hall to bring it up to the standards, but the second phase, the basement improvements, have not been completed. As you know, about a little over a year ago, we completed the crawl space improvements. I'm here to report to you that they are working well and working as designed, and we're very pleased with those. But the second phase of these improvements, we'd like for the basement section of it, is to stop water infiltration that we're getting in. Typically right now, we're averaging on a 1-inch rain or greater, we're actually getting water infiltration into the basement. Probably about three times this past year, we've had to come down there where we've had about a half an inch to 3/4 water, we had to shot back up and stuff. So we'll be looking to do some improvements there to stop that water infiltration.
Is there not a sump down there?
No, sir, it's not a sump.
Okay.
There is a sump, but it's in the crawl space. We do not have one in the basement, the back half.
But it is a cement floor.
It is a cement floor, yes, sir. There is a portion of it where the old coal boiler used to sit that is dirt and gravel at this time. It's approximately, I'd say, 8x30 or something like that. It's still open.
The other question that I have before you move
yes,
on,
sir.
Have you ever actually had a security breach at Public Works where something went missing or something of that nature?
Not to our knowledge. I will report to you that a couple times over this past year that I've asked the police chief to pick patrols up there. Our cleaning staff has felt uncomfortable. They've seen people walking around, kind of hanging around the right of way in the street, and they didn't feel comfortable. And so I reached out to our police chief to kind of ask for a little more picked up patrols, maybe to even sit across in the lot at Comfort Master to maybe do some of their daily reporting and stuff, just to have a little more presence than the hours that our cleaning staff is there by themselves.
Okay.
Any other questions? All right, well, that's the list of the needs. And thank you, Robin. And you clearly know we can't afford everything that's on our needs. And so having back to my days in finance, revenues have got to equal expenditures. And so we want to make sure that any revenue that we show equals our total expenditures. One of the things we try to do in this table is if you look right to left, those items that are expenditures are being matched up with the revenue on the left-hand side. So for example, we're proposing at Five County Stadium for the parking lot lighting LED conversion to fund that out of the capital reserve. The fire alarm at the fire station will be funded by half cost of the Wake County fire cost share at $12,650. And then capital reserve fund balance will fund the automated gate just for the maintenance yard. We pulled back on the number of cameras at the Public Works facility and panic button to get it to 3,900. It's also funding the town hall basement improvements. And then of course, as Joe outlined earlier, that there's a half cent tax increase that balances total revenue and expenditures. So from a property management standpoint, this is what we're proposing to you for fiscal year 2017, and I'll be glad to answer any questions.
Have they, Wake County Fire, have they approved half and half, Chris, of the firearm? Wake County, they approved it, or?
Mr. Perry, Chris had told me basically at this time they have pledged 50% of that item. I'm not.
You still got extended to a 25,000, you got revenue 12, so.
The rest of it comes from us.
The rest of it comes from us. Yes, sir. If it's approved through their budget process, Chris can give you a little more update on their budget process. But as we work together for this, he has told me to go ahead and plan on receiving it as high on their priority to be funded.
And that sounds like a lot, $25,000 for the fire alarm in the bedroom.
We are, it's actually for the whole facility. We're replacing the fire alarm for the whole facility, we're replacing it with a non-proprietary. System, so we will not have where you only have to buy a certain brand manufacturers. The system will be very similar that we put in here at Town Hall, police station, and community center.
And what kind of response time would you have for a fire at the fire station, Chris?
I would hope it would be pretty good. and I can add just a little bit of information on the county's commitment. That project was submitted to them as part of their what they call facility improvements, and it has been included in their recommended budget. The fire commission will actually vote on that this Thursday night, but it is on the staff budget as well as the fire commission recommended budget to go to the manager. That project is.
Okay,
percentage still 50%?
Yeah, very good question. The amount that was included in that budget is at 43.16%, which is slightly less than 50%. That's a product of the cost share adjustment they are intended to implement. We have some discussions with them regarding bringing that back to 50%, but the budgeted amount is at 43.16.
I think I need to add to that, they have said that they would keep us whole in this. That scares me when somebody says we're going to hold you harmless. But for this year,
down that road.
For this year itself, we feel like we're okay.
No, that doesn't apply to capital. They've made that distinction clear.
Okay. It does into operations.
That's what they're saying.
Okay. My mistake.
And we've had some conversations with them about that, but have yet to get a full commitment on the 50%.
So then, in Curtis's question, this has been submitted at 50 or at 43?
It was submitted at 50, and it's being recommended at 43.16, which is about 10 and some change, I think, is the difference.
So this 12,650 is not a correct number.
That is at the 50%.
We would have to, if they go forward their recommended budget, we would have to come up with a couple more $1,000.
Okay.
Potentially.
Okay.
One of the things I want to tell you as we move forward tonight, we do have some pictures of some of these items. That if you're interested in, like the basement, some of the water that we've seen down there, or some of the automated gates and stuff we're looking at. So at any point through this process that you want to know a little more about it, clearly I got a bunch of information in the box here we can share with you, and we also got some pictures. So if there's something you're interested in seeing, just ask. We'll be here to help you. Any other questions about 2017?
Chris, you got office cameras?
Yes, sir. At the Public Works facility, we're going to do two cameras. One will be at the front door and one at the back door. And the other portion of that is a panic button for the administrative assistant up front.
So if somebody comes to visit, you'll see them and you'll let them in, or can they walk?
They'll be able to walk in. We'll see them before they come. The monitor will be on the administrative assistant's desk there, so she'll see someone coming in. And then if at some point where that individual or a cleaning staff member doesn't feel comfortable, they can push the panic button, and then we'll also have available for our cleaning contracting staff.
What does a panic button do? Is it
locked? Basically, a panic button is like a silent alarm. It goes straight out to a monitoring service that then calls our police department, very similar to what we have at the community center.
How about your equipment out in the park? You don't think you need a camera?
We clearly would like one in the original. If you saw a slide back, we did have a little more dollars to try to get out to the fuel system and get a little more of an angle out to the maintenance yard. But of course, recognizing there's limited resources, we had to scale back somewhere. So we kind of looked at this as maybe phase one, maybe something that, and as we expand our facility there, maybe we can incorporate it as part of that. But just a way of trying to balance these numbers, we scaled that piece back a little bit. All right. 2018. Basically, for 2018, we're looking at starting a part of that facility master plan for Public Works due to the limited revenues that we are generating this year of $54,000. We'll be starting the Public Works facility master plan in March, funding majority of that. And you'll see the following year we pick up the remaining piece of that master plan. We also, as part of expenditures, we're looking to replace the fire station water line. As you can see from the previous pages, the price has went up a little bit. That's the cost price index we've increased there. And so we bring expenditures from the property management standpoint of $54,375, which is being balanced by the half-cent tax increase that Joe mentioned earlier, and a cost share from Wake County. And that is at 50%. One of the things that you'll see us, that we're going to be recommending as part of the operating budget in 2018, we think it's important to, at this point, is to do a facility condition assessment to kind of take a look at all of our roofs, all our buildings, look at the windows, exterior walls, foundations, where our HVAC is and electrical components. And so we can get a comprehensive list that we can build and for our CIP as we go forward. So something has not been done in my tenure here that I think is, as we keep adding square footage, it's starting to get a larger and larger piece to manage. And times these time frames where these go out, we just think one comprehensive report would be beneficial to us as a long range planning tool. Any questions for 2018? Hearing none, we'll move forward. 2019, very similar to the previous years. We're finishing up the master plan as mentioned, part two for the Public Works facility. And we're replacing two HVAC units at the Public Works facility. One unit is 2004 and one is 2007. And the typical useful life for HVAC units is 12 to 14 years. And those fall in that category. So we are with the tax.
Would you just replace it automatically, Chris, or would you just wait till it fails so we replace it?
We would recommend to go ahead and replace them as part of the budget process and not for them to wait till they fail. Due to the fact that you have to then, if it's in the wintertime or in a dead heat of summer, we have to emergency kind of move and pick up processes. We can't plan. We're probably going to be a little more limited on the supplies we can get in hand. A lot of times now, manufacturers do not stock a lot of different units. They build them as you need them, and so we would recommend to go ahead and do replacements. I know as a long-term cost savings as far as maintenance and getting more efficient units.
One thing, this $40,000 on the half cent, there's no inflation for increased
tax. That's correct. We did not include that. We tried to be conservative. We recognize that as time grows, there is potentially for that 40 to be maybe 44, 45. But we wanted to try to stay conservative and just be flat there. Clearly, as we move forward, there, you know, get updated each year. We can adjust those numbers as we actually recognize the revenue. But now we wanted to stay conservative and make sure we kind of brought
it
in.
I figured you knew it. I just wondered why you didn't figure some growth in it.
Okay. It's just a conservative measure, sir.
Okay.
End of day. With hearing no other questions from 2019, 2020, we are looking at that point in time. We feel like it's appropriate to sit down and start talking about fire station facility needs. Whether it's a station number two, whether it's renovation to the current station, we don't know where that process is going, but we feel like a facility assessment is needed to meet the needs of our fire department. We're putting $20,000 aside to conduct that assessment to see what their needs are and how to best serve those needs. Also, as part of the budget, we're also setting aside $109,000 in a capital reserve for future debt service payment to buy down the debt for whatever renovations or new facilities designed. It also corresponds with ending of some installment payments at the Parks and Recs facility, community center, and some of the ball field lights that we mentioned earlier. It also starts the first phase of the facility master plan improvements at Public Works at $130,000. And it's also recommending that we install an automatic transfer switch for the generator here at the town hall facilities. Currently now, it is a manual process that has to be done by Public Works, and an automatic transfer switch will allow us to, within 15 to 20 seconds, have this building back up and on utility power, not having to wait on Public Works to bring it up in 30 to 45, depending on whether we're on site or not. So again, we're balancing the revenues and expenditures at 289, with a revenue of 289 and expenditures of 289. Any questions?
Chris, since I'm retired, I want to kind of a little bit interested in this mm-hmm. stuff. Do you think by the year 2020 that this property out there by the water tank is still going to be a good place, or? I mean,
that's exactly what we want to look into. We know we've got existing needs, even completely separate from the substation idea. The building we're in was originally constructed, as Chris mentioned earlier, in 1974. We're severely limited. We can't even walk between some of the trucks now. We got four people sharing one office and that kind of stuff. So that is today. So then when we put on top of that the idea of do we need a second fire station, we find ourselves with more questions than we do answers. So this is intended to, kind of like Chris described with the Public Works Master Plan, is to identify what do we need and what's the most cost-effective way to meet those needs, whether it's through our existing facility or a second facility.
We may just decide it. We just need a new fire station in the middle of our
most definitely district. It may be most cost-effective just to build a new site instead of trying to maintain two sites or create a second site, just do one main site somewhere that accommodates our needs.
So it's not too early to start planning that, is it?
No, sir, not at all.
In 2020 will be on us before we know it. Any further questions? Okay. Thank you, guys. 2021, basically we're doing a lot of the similar things that we've done in 2020. We're setting funds aside for the capital reserve for the fire station, whether it is to pay a debt service, is it to pay for design, we're not sure yet, but we want to set aside some funds recognizing we will have some expenditures there. Same way with the Public Works facility, we'll be completing the second phase of facility improvements down there at 125. And then at this point, we're also anticipating that the Zebulon Municipal Complex will need some bathroom renovations. The bathrooms in the police station and second floor of town hall will be approximately 30 years old and in need from just some updating and some replacements. And that's balanced out at $39,000, bringing us a grand total of $289,000.
Yeah, we should be considering some kind of development fees for a fire station.
You want to take that one?
We can do anything. it comes down to, well, if it's legal, okay. It comes down to where you want to put the burden. If we always need to be conscientious of putting too much burden on new development if it makes an impact. I will say that I am encouraged by what I hear from developers when they do cost comparisons to land and building out here as opposed to Raleigh and Durham. The cost factor for Durham, as an example, is 2 and 3 times higher. The cost factor for Raleigh is 4 and 5 times higher. And when I talk to them and I say things like 5-cent property tax, it's like no sweat. It's like, do it. If you have to do that for your infrastructure, do it. It's not gonna be a factor. So I would like to say intuitively, something like a development fee for a fire station is probably not gonna swing the difference on future development. It's just something that we need to be conscientious of, that's all.
One of the other things that we've talked about internally is as we grow and these larger tracts of developments come on board, maybe it's an opportunity that we can partner with them, kind of like Weaver's Pond did with the school, and maybe partner with them and carve out a couple acres of land for our fire department. So if we determine the site there on Green Pace is not appropriate. But so it's one of those ideas, kind of like Mr. Strickland said, we got to start thinking and about those things. They'll be here before we know it. But there's another opportunity that we might get in buying something, a larger piece of pie, get the unit cost down, and where we can partner with that developer to potentially put out a station there.
Well, we've had some revenue from the sale of the current site that we own, which I will say again, I never liked. I think it's not in the right place. But, you know, we need to, be open.
Would you, Chris, consider an EMS fire station combination, or is that just too much? Would Wake County be more involved in it like that? And
They have expressed interest since, I guess, the Station 2 project was discussed. EMS expressed a desire to co-locate with us. That has some operational stuff to definitely take in consideration, but it does provide another revenue stream to help with that project, and it's become a very commonplace to see EMS units staffed in fire stations. It's very efficient to do that, have them co-locate in the same facility.
Yeah, and I can tell you, I serve on Nationwide EMS Board, and there is still interest in that. One of the problems in this location out here was they figured that they had to acquire more land, and they were unable to do that. I mean, the people that owned it just were not open to carving more out for them. But everybody understands that, you know, it's practical, less expensive than building two separate locations, and to be able to co-locate has a lot of benefits.
Do they rent this building there in? Is it, are they rented? Is it rented? Or do they own it? EMS?
They're doing a new one in Wendell, and this one is owned. In fact, they did, I forget the number, but a fair amount of renovations was done on this building maybe 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
I want to say somewhere in the $40,000 to $50,000 range, but I don't know. I wouldn't guarantee that because I don't remember the exact number. But that was to give it another between 5 and 10 year life. And again, it's already been a couple of years. So.
Mm-hmm. Only other piece I'd want to note on the 2021 piece, at the end of 2021, we'll have a little over $234,000 built up for a capital reserve if we haven't moved sooner and all toward a new fire station, renovations, whatever our future plans may hold. Well, if you got any other questions, be glad to answer that. Is there any additional clarification needed on the items presented? Any other projects out there we have not taken in consideration? And we just want to do a reminder that we are recommending in 2018 that we do a facility assessments, and we could be adjusting these slightly based on that. But we'll be sharing that report with y'all.
Chris, I see your water fees are staying the same. Do you see any increase in that anytime between?
Currently, in this current budget, we are not projecting any increase in stormwater fees.
I'm talking about the 2021. Do you see?
We have not, in the stormwater presentation we're going to give shortly, is not projecting any increase. We're trying to use existing funding for that. But clearly, there is some definite need for stormwater, and I think as we move further into these CIP projects, that's something we'll need to consider. I wouldn't want to take it off the table, but right now it's not included.
Okay.
Anything else on property management before we move forward? While Robin's switching these over, I guess the next presentation we'll move forward and talk a little bit about is greenways and sidewalks and stuff. Curly, as Joe mentioned earlier, that we are including as part of this budget a half-cent tax increase. We feel like this gives us one of the goals that Joe outlined in his budget as returns on investments, that greenways and sidewalks will be ultimately be returns on increased property values and ultimately higher tax revenues. The guiding framework for this CIP presentation and the objectives for this was the completion of the Shepherd School sidewalk project that's out there. We recently have adopted three different plans over the years that kind of reinforced the need for sidewalks, from a 2015 Greenway Master Plan to improve connectivity and alternate means of transportation and promote healthy living. The comprehensive plan does the same thing to promote multiple use of trails for connectivity and pedestrian destinations. And the 2004 transportation plan promotes the development of sidewalks and greenways as opportunities for short trips, thus reducing congestion for roadways. So those were the objectives and the plans that this board has adopted over the years that help support and bring the framework to the 2017 CIP projects. The first project we have on the list is the Beaver Dam Creek Greenway. It is the design of phase one that connects Tarrant Meadows to Weaver's Pond. It's approximately 6,400 linear feet of greenway. It includes the permitting, the survey, and the geotechnical work. The second project on the list here is the Shepherd School Road sidewalk project. It's the completing that portion of the project, that second phase of that project. It is an 80-20 grant match with Wake County CDBG funds. It's installing about 875 linear feet of sidewalk and about 580 linear feet of curb and gutter. The third project we have listed here is the downtown railroad track crossing sidewalk. Basically, we're tying this project to a stormwater project improvement, and basically what it's going to allow us to do is get across the railroad track. It's design and construction administration and additional insurance for having to deal and working around a railroad track. The fourth project we have listed here is the municipal complex walking trail. It's basically tying to the existing sidewalk system here at the municipal complex and adding 650 linear feet of sidewalk, some crosswalks, some gate improvements, and some signage, estimated at $24,000. And then a downtown urban walking trail to connect the downtown corridor and all around Barber Street back up toward Gannon with some improvements at intersections, estimated at $165,000. What we're recommending as the part of the 2017 proposed funding schedule is the completion of the Shepherd School Road sidewalks. So you can see here that matching portion of that grant is $32,000 that'd be coming from the town coffers. The second item under the expenditures is $124,000. What that is a reduction from the original on the first page, which we're not including the northern quarter of that greenway that was originally laid out in our greenway master plans, just to fit it in the dollars we had. It's some kind of, there's a little bit of redundancy there, so we're taking that piece of the quarter out and reducing that to $124,000. Then we talked about earlier the downtown Zebulon railroad track crossing. It's approximately roughly 55 to 65 linear feet of sidewalk to be put in to connect, avoiding the sidewalk there, estimated at $25,000, bringing expenditures to $181,000. One of the big things that we're doing, and you'll see a lot through this greenway sidewalk bicycle piece, is we're trying to leverage tax dollars through multiple grants, and to use some transportation fees and stuff, and it'll be a little more evident as we move forward. But the revenue side here is the half-cent tax increase, a fund balance appropriation of $92,000 to get some seed money for the Beaver Dam project. It's also pairing that with the existing John Rex endowment grant of $24,000. Those funds are in hand right now and can be used toward greenways. And then we're pledging the $25,000 from transportation impact fees to complete the downtown railroad crossing. So balancing our revenues and expenditures at 181. I'll be glad to answer any questions.
The question that I have has to do with the project on south of Rendell at Harris Barbershop.
Yes, sir.
I'm going through the budget document that I have on page D4. There is a $25,000 for the railroad crossing,
mm-hmm.
and then on page D5 there's $41,000.
Yes, sir.
So, how much of that is really?
It's $41,000 for the stormwater piece to be fixed, and in that process, we're going to put in a driveway apron there, which will add some sidewalk there, and then the $25,000 is where that roughly 30 foot driveway ends and extends to the where the sidewalk stops south of the railroad track. So it's a combined total to fix the drainage there at Harris Barbershop of $41,000 and $25,000 to get across the railroad track.
But you really can't do one without the other particular, can you?
The storm drainage one probably could stand on its own, but it's still avoiding the sidewalk. It does not connect those pieces.
And I got that, but I mean, it just looked to me like the project was split up in two separate numbers here.
It is. It is.
And I need you to understand.
It is a combined two. When we bid the project, do the project, it'll be done as one. But the way we broke the funding from stormwater, we wanted to have certain funds donated to stormwater and certain done to greenways and sidewalks. We split the funding mechanism.
My question again, and you answered one half of it. Can you do the sidewalk without the storm drain? You said you can do the storm drain without the sidewalk.
No, sir. We need, when we're there, we need to fix the storm drainage.
Okay, so you can do storm drainage and not do sidewalk.
Yes.
But not vice versa.
That's correct.
Gotcha. Okay, thank you.
Has mm-hmm. that been designed yet, Chris? That's
no, sir, none of that's been designed. We've done.
Not a big step up by that Harrison Barbershop.
Yeah, basically, we're going to basically raise that elevation up there for that driveway entrance back here. You know, behind Harris Barbershop, there's quite a bit of parking. So we're going to put a driveway apron in there that's approximately 30 feet wide. Behind that, we'll put a 6-foot sidewalk, and then we'll taper down. And as part of those improvements, we'll put in two drop inlets to take care of the storm drainage. And then ultimately, like the mayor said, we'll tie to that that driveway apron and cross the railroad track and tie to the existing sidewalk.
Yeah, the big problem is the ponding of the water. So it is a storm drain problem more so than a sidewalk.
That is correct.
Now, I understand the value of both, but...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the priority there is definitely storm drainage up at Richard Harris.
Oh, yeah, I know that's a lot of water.
Sir.
This walking trail, municipal complex walking trail, I'm not familiar with that one, I don't think.
Which one, sir?
The
Beaver Dam?
No, not the Beaver Dam, the municipal complex.
The municipal complex one. Basically, Greg, it's a project Greg's been working on, and basically what he, from my understanding, is he want to add sidewalk to the back here along the Green Giants and extend it along the back lawn side of the property to Judge Street. Take that gate, put install a gate there, get access to the sidewalk that's already there, and where you can make a loop around the facility.
Okay. And the walking, the urban, downtown urban walking trail?
Basically, that is, my understanding is that basically connecting missing pieces from sidewalk on Arundel Avenue all the way down to Barbie Street, over to Barbie Street, up to Wakefield, getting across another railroad track crossing, getting back up to Gannon Avenue, making some intersection improvements at multiple places as we cross. Greg, you got any more detail on that one that you can provide these guys?
I mean, these two that I,
that's not proposed until 2020.
That's correct.
2020 is the proposed date on that.
The piece for Town Hall is proposed a little bit later.
Right.
The urban walking trail ultimately did not get into our budget.
Right.
Yeah, I just want to be clear.
The downtown trail does go along the Randall. It goes a Randall to Gannon Avenue, from Gannon to Wakefield, and Wakefield to Barbie Street, and that gives you a very close to a mile walk. It's a loop. A lot of the funds are going into pedestrian crossings, to where you have lights for your pedestrians to utilize.
Okay, I need to look at that route one.
Me too.
I mean, we got walks running down Wakefield Street.
Let me offer some commentary on this. We don't know that that's necessarily going to be a priority for you. What we're trying to do is put out there just ideas of projects further down the road. What we think that you're going to need to do after you take care of these existing missing gaps, Shepherd School being one, South Arundel being another, is we need to use that time to develop what other communities do. Some of them call them pedestrian ranking criteria, but it's similar to what you all use with your street system, where you have a bunch of different criteria and you determine which is your highest priority street to pave. There's other communities out there that have similar criteria, but it's for pedestrian activities, for sidewalks. So what we would like to do is, if this does get funded, we would like to bring back to you some policy guidance so we could determine really where your next projects are. And it might be a downtown loop. It might be a municipal complex walking trail, and it may not. There's some other projects that we presented. Stronach is an example. Privet is an example. Wakefield might be an example. So the fact that we're putting projects in here in future years is not necessarily to mean to reflect that we think that you need to go there. It's just that we think you need to put money towards pedestrian activity, and where those projects wind up being will be a reflection of this ranking criteria that you all have brought before you at a future date.
I mean, I'm definitely in favor of sidewalks and walking, but I just, those two that kind of, I don't recall seeing those before. A question.
Is there any significance, I'm sorry, I'm just curious, to the downtown Zebulon Railroad track crossing in 2017 expenditure showing in red instead of black?
The reason is it was a placeholder to note that we're still finalizing that estimate. It's a note to myself. I probably should have moved it from the PowerPoint. Green, that was a last minute add from staff and green engineers.
And that's fine. I just like,
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, yeah. Sometimes I hit the red button on my computer. All right.
And that's what it is. We're still fine-tuning that number, and that's our placeholder at this point, sir.
Okay.
Does that include any of Norfolk Southern's fee or
yes,
insurance?
Sir. That's the part we're trying to nail down, and that was one of the biggest pieces of the stormwater improvements piece, and this one is the $41,000 for Richard Harris is, I believe, almost $10,000 of fees for the railroad track alone, just for the right to do work on their railroad. So that's one of the pieces where we're trying to nail down as we now are just working on the right-of-way. Now we're looking to cross it with a sidewalk. What additional fees are they going to do as far as additional insurance, protocols, and we're trying to fine-tune that piece of number there.
Any ideas on Wake County helping out with any of the Greenway fees?
Right now, from my understanding, there is no available funds from open space or for Greenway design in communities. That is something they're looking at to do down the road. Right now there's nothing available, sir. Potentially in the future there could be other projects.
I know they've approved something for Wake Forest, they've approved something for Apex in their funding. just kind of curious.
There's also proposed, at least, I don't know if it'll get on the ballot, but Sig Hutchinson has proposed a Greenway bond, of which I think we would probably be eligible. I don't remember the number, maybe $1 million of it. It would be available to $1 million to each of the 12 communities and then $12 million out in the county. It's my recall now. I wouldn't go out and shout hallelujah. Yes, that's absolutely right. But that is a bond that's not yet been put up nor voted on. I don't know if it's going to make it this fall or not. I'll see him this weekend so I can find out more on that.
Chris?
Yes, sir.
You know, I got a question.
No problem.
Beaver Dam.
Yes, sir.
I mean, this, the new sewer line going in, is that Beaver Dam?
Mm-hmm.
Is that, you know, it's wide and all, you know, and is that going to be incorporated into our Greenway, or can it be, or?
It's part of our, it shows up in our Greenway Master Plan.
It does?
Yes, sir. As part of our Greenway Master Plan, we are ultimately looking to, down the road, next 15, 20 years as Zebulon develops and developments come along there, we are looking to put a Greenway in that corridor. Actually, Shepherd's Park, the plans that you approved on Old Bun Road do and show a small section of that Greenway being built by those developers as part of that special use permit. So yes, sir, we do see that corridor all the way from 64 back over to Weaver's Pond ultimately being developed over the next 20, 30 years. That's a long range plan because it's a long distance.
But it's important, I think, to point out that the sewer line easement does not allow for walking. So you have to go back and get walking included and probably at an additional fee into the easement in order to do it. We asked Raleigh if they would do that when they acquired the easements, and they said no, they don't
really
do that. Really?
Like walking won't hurt it.
They just don't do it.
They don't even do it for their own departments.
That's a waste. That's really a waste.
I fully
and
agree,
we want
but
this.
You needed to know that.
No, you know, we're talking about spending all this money for Greenways, and they just opened up a big one in town. You know, that's maybe we should go back again and say, look, you know, we.
One of the things that's good about it, that when the sewer line goes in there, clearly it changes the use of the property. It also devalues the property a little bit. So when we do come, it is a lesser cost. The property is not worth as much, that portion of it, because it's got a sewer easement on there. So the property value that we buy it at, to put the walking easement overlay on that, should be at least dollars.
But the easement is less, but the adjacent property is more.
But yes, that is correct.
Because of it having the utilities to it.
Mm-hmm. One of the other benefits is that easement is already cleared. We don't have to pay for clearing for that easement. So there's some benefits there.
Will it be kept clean? Do they keep that easement clean, Chris?
City of Raleigh is responsible for keeping those access. Their sewer permit requires them to be able to keep access to that. And so their mowing requirements are not quite as what we used to do when we were in the water and sewer business, but They are responsible to keeping it clear and free for them to get access to it for maintenance purposes and emergencies. Any other questions? All right, moving on to 2018. Clearly, we mentioned earlier that as we move forward with these greenway plans and sidewalk plans, we'd have to leverage a significant amount of dollars to accomplish this. The Greenway Beaver Dam Creek Greenway Phase 1 construction cost estimate is $826. To accomplish that, I think we're really leveraging a lot of dollars. We're leveraging the half-cent tax increase. We're getting some fees in lieu from D.R. Horton. We're also currently working with our attorney on a development agreement for Weaver's Pond for some of the easements to be free. Also part of that is they'll be generating some funds for us for pet waste stations, benches, trash receptacles. Part of the 2017 budget process will be working on grant application to the NC Parks and Rec Trust Fund. Greenways are really big with the trust fund right now. The last time we got a grant from them was in 2009 for our community center. We feel very optimistic about that ability and our ability to secure that grant. We're also getting positive feedback from John Rex Endowment as they may be a new potential partner as we move forward into construction. They're very positive about our Greenway Master Plan, the work we've been doing to date. And so we feel like there's another grant opportunity there. There's a couple other grants out there that we potentially could go after, Blue Cross Blue Shield or Duke Energy, to look at potentially maybe doing some educational stages, stations throughout there, or some signage. But a couple other things that we'll be looking through the 2017 budget year to match that. Clearly, if we don't get these grants, we cannot meet this funding schedule. It's very much leveraged. Don't want to hide that process. Tell you, we got to work very hard in 2017 fiscal year to accomplish any goals in the 2018 to get to that greenway to be installed. So, and then the last piece of it is starting at capital reserve from some transportation app piece for sidewalks. Kind of like Joe said, we'll be developing that matrix to see where our priorities would be, and we're just setting dollars aside to potentially, once that matrix is developed and we know your priorities, that we can fund those pieces. Any questions? A lot of leverage in there. A lot of ifs. Hopefully that would be something. We've been successful in the past in this organization securing grants. We are optimistic we can get them again and we can put this greenway on the ground. But we're going to have some help from significant other partners and players. Any other questions? Hearing none, we'll move on to the 2019. From an expenditure standpoint there, we have placed an item out there for consideration. The East Tronic North Whitley sidewalks. It's approximately 260 linear feet on North Whitley, 905 feet on Stronach. We are matching that with a CDBG grant. Just as a note, we're eligible for $313,000 for CDBG grant over the next 5 years. Shepherd School Road would be taking 128 of it, and this project is estimated at 230, and so 184 would be coming from CDBG. So basically at that point in time, we had exhausted all CDBG funds for that 5 year period. Clearly this line item is balanced with a half a cent tax increase, and total revenues equal 46 and expenditures equal 46. Any questions about the Stronach Street project? Hearing none, we'll move forward to the 2020. This is the year that we look to try to come back complete the walking trail here at the municipal complex. Like, kind of like Joe said, we'll see how these things weigh out on our matrix. But just a reminder, it's about 600 linear 50 feet of sidewalk here. The number is a little bit higher than from the first page. It's got a CPI built in it for the several years. And we just had a plug entry carrying your capital reserve for sidewalk for $5,000. At that point in time, at the end of 2020, you'll have $25,000 in capital reserve for sidewalk. Unfortunately, $40,000 just don't buy the whole sidewalk. Any other questions?
Hey, Chris, you don't, don't have any expenditures except for and CDBG money except for 2019.
Shepherd School Road for 2017 is $160,000, of which $128,000 is grant. So you add the $128,000 for the Shepherd School Road plus the $184,000 for Stronach and Whitley, giving you a total of $313,000 or $312,000 is $1,000 left. You might as well say it's over. Shepherd School Road, basically, what the number that you see here on Shepherd School Road in 2017 is our match portion. The total cost of that project is $160,000. And the CDBG grant portion of it is $128,000. So our $32,000 plus $128,000 equals the total project cost of $160,000.
I understand. This doesn't show, does it?
This doesn't what, sir?
Because our expenditure is not there.
Yeah.
All right. And then basically, if moving to 2021, basically we're still looking at a reserve potentially for Greenway, something we can do use again as leverage. Basically, we're setting up a reserve for sidewalks and greenways, trying to leverage that with other grant opportunities, maybe safe routes from school. Maybe some other funds that, like the mayor said, the bond referendum come out. So we're basically setting reserves to kind of plan for the future and recognizing there's additional needs. Any questions? Any clarifications? Any projects you'd like to see added to the list? So, one point as we're kind of wrapping up here, I'd like to emphasize as far as one of Joe's goals was to get returns on investments. Greenways, there was a 2009 study that came out that basically looked at 90,000 U.S. home sales across the United States, and they said development of greenways and walkable communities added $4,000 to $34,000 in higher property values. So that's where we get the returns on investment, that we're getting higher property values. One of the unique pieces about that study was the $34,000 was in Charlotte. It was in North Carolina. So clearly each community is a little bit different in the walkabilities, but clearly investments in greenways do ultimately give you return on investment, meeting one of our goals of this budget process.
I know that quite interesting. I thought, I believe it was Saturday morning that we watch UNCEX right much,
mm-hmm.
and they had they have North Carolina today, whatever it is, and the emphasis of that that show was the walking trails and greenway systems in North Carolina, and they expressed that how much it improved property values, quality of life, and so forth. But the whole show was on greenways, walking trails, and nature trails, and all that kind of stuff. So mm-hmm. very interesting.
Chris, I got one. there's two sidewalks going up Gannon, right? One of them gives out.
Okay.
Gives out at the Rotary, is that right?
Mm-hmm. On the right-hand side, yes, sir.
Yeah. Is that, have you looked at, you got to cross the street, somewhere to get to the other side to walk to the shopping center. Have you looked at a crosswalk at Wakefield and Gannon?
No, we have not, but
a signal crosswalk where you can cross over and get back, where you can go to the...
Wakefield Street, that's part of the walkability piece that Greg was talking about, the urban walkability, and that intersection would be improved potentially there, but I have not particularly looked at that intersection and pulled it out and generated some kind of cost for pedestrian improvements there.
Because if you went on that property, what they're doing at the house, it really doesn't go anywhere, does it?
It basically, the sidewalk terminates down there toward the restaurants and stuff down there at the Red Snapper and the Mexican restaurant.
I see people running across the street and all. I'm just wondering if there's something we can think about doing in the future where they can get across the road safely and.
On the south side, does it go beyond Rotary Drive?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
It goes all the way over to
I know it does on the north side, but I don't know.
It goes on the south side.
It does, yeah.
Yeah, there's 4-foot sidewalk there being all the way up to the house that's being remodeled. And then there's a piece right there at, that's an island, I believe.
Well, the house is being remodeled. Is there a sidewalk in front of it?
Yes,
see,
sir.
I never walked that side of the street.
Yeah. In reality, the city of Raleigh is getting ready to rip that up and actually put some water main reinforcements. And when they put it back, instead of 4 foot, we've got them to put 5 foot back. So we'll have a little bit of an improvement there.
Good.
Just to follow up.
You're going to get in trouble again.
Is it on?
Oh, yeah.
Curtis is asking about the crosswalk at Gannon and Wakefield. And the downtown loop that we were talking about includes crosswalks, pedestrian lighting, your ped heads and things like that.
Yeah, it is dangerous. You take your life in your own hand, you cross that road.
All right, guys, thank you for bearing with us, and we'll head into our last portion tonight of presentations to be stormwater. And it's the last piece of, again, managing our investments. And as Joe mentioned, as just a reminder, the $108,000 is being pledged as part of this budget toward capital and moving forward. The objectives of this CIP project is permit compliance with the municipal system and the industrial permits for stormwater, and the goal to eliminate nuisance flooding on North Wakefield Street, Yates Place, South Arundel, and West Sycamore Street. The 2017 project list, we have broken this, the Yates Place Phase 2 stormwater design and permitting into a separate cost. We've also, the construction cost for Yates Place and the construction engineering inspection is estimated at $309. North Wakefield drainage improvements, that is an update from the Wooten Company from Franklin to Glenn. Those drainage improvements are estimated at $100,000 to put in the driveway culverts, put in some pipe, remove some pipe, move some clean outs, and some other electrical pieces. So the drainage improvements on Wakefield Street are estimated at $100,000. South Arundel Avenue drainage improvements, we already spoke about a little bit tonight there in front of Mr. Harris's barbershop, are 41, a large portion of that being the railroad fees associated with it, and a stormwater inspection camera. Basically, right now, we do not have a camera like you might have in the sewer where you actually crawls up in it and pans ahead. Those are very expensive. They could be as much as $60,000 or $70,000. There's technologies come out here with a camera that's on a pole that shoots a light up in there, and then we can see 300 or 400 feet, which helps us with inspection of areas that are trouble, new inspection and stuff. So that's an item we're requesting as part of this budget at $17,000.
Could you rent one?
Not the pole camera, you cannot rent.
Or could you partner with Wendell? Can we partner and share?
Potentially, that's something we could share with a camera. It's a good item to potentially share with them. Cameras, we do rent from time to time as we need them. They just changed the wheel size on the dimer from a company can do sewer cameraing, can also do stormwater. They just changed the wheels on it and do that. Okay. Time to time, we've had to rent that and pay for that out of professional services.
Chris, my understanding on Yates Place, Phase 2 was to see if Phase 1 resolved the issue before we ran out there into Phase 2.
Phase 1 is going to take care of the flooding in the cul-de-sac. It will not eliminate the gutter spread in Phase 2 area.
But the idea was to see if that would clear it out quicker.
It will eliminate the flooding, but it does not stop the gutter spread that we're having up there. The hydraulic calculations that Leo has run say that we're going to have significant gutter spread out there. And our goal is to match those improvements to what we've seen in new subdivisions.
The whole concept was to not have to do that. My recall is that when we went into it, originally it came in and said, we need to put in storm drainage and catch basins and on and on and on. And we said, no, let's go down and put in larger things, what we're doing.
Yeah, we're doing.
And that hopefully that would resolve the problem and we'd never have to do phase two.
From the engineering calculations we've done, it resolves the flooding. It does not take care of the gutter spread in the water into the
road. And how much of a problem is the gutter spread?
The gutter spread is to two parts. We're having problems at the intersection of Coventry and Yates, where that water is coming across there, it's freezing up. We're having to treat it. Also, anytime it's effectively managing roadways, we want to get water out of the roadway. So that water coming out into the street is now getting more opportunities to be saturated into the roadway. And water is just like in our basement, it's an enemy of the structure of the road. So anytime we can get that water off the road more effectively and efficiently, the better off we'll be, and you'll get a longer structural life of your roadway.
And I understand that. What I'm struggling with, is it really a $400,000 problem?
That's what the engineering costs say that it's going to be. Clearly we got...
That's not my point. Is it really worth spending that kind of money? Is the problem bad enough that we have to spend that kind of money?
Basically, if we are basically looking at it as a way we want to match our new subdivision, what our developers put in, we're trying to bring Yates up to that same standard and all.
Is that necessary?
In our opinion and the engineer's opinion, yes, sir.
They'd find a new engineer.
Okay.
You know I'm teasing.
I know that.
No, I really do have those concerns, though. Is the problem bad enough that we need to spend that kind of money when we need it in other areas?
It's definitely a significant cost, and that's something we'll have to evaluate as a group.
Okay.
Well, that mistake was made when the subdivision was approved.
We're still draining, you know, we're taking care of the flooding in the cul-de-sac. We're still up to the cul-de-sac draining 11 acres of land and three roadways. There's three sets of roadway from Derby, Coventry, and Yates that do not have a catch basin on it until you get to Yates Place. So there's a lot of linear feet of street and acreage that we're draining without a catch basin. So
the problem mainly is at that intersection?
It's basically all along. It's at the intersection of Coventry and Yates, there is a problem, but it's all along Yates Place, the drainage down through there. Even a small rain event of less than an inch, we're getting water outside of the gutter line and into your roadway.
Well, I like the point of going down there when it rains just so I can have a picture in my head. Okay, proceed.
All right. So we're up to that. Proposed funding for 2017, you see, is we're looking to do the design, permitting, and easement acquisition that we'll need for Yates Place, estimated at $40,000. We're going to look to make the improvements for South Rendell drainage improvements and for Mr. Harris, we've been talking about earlier. And also, we have budgeted funds for North Wakefield drainage improvements from Franklin to West Glen at 100, which balances, comes to a total expenditures of 181. As we mentioned earlier, we're showing revenues of stormwater fee of 108, and we're doing a fund balance appropriation of 73,000, balancing our revenues and expenditures to a total of 181.
That storm drainage on that we were talking about from Glen to Franklin Street.
Yes, sir.
And that's what we talked about doing those. Is that going to help the situation, or is that going to make the situation worse?
These improvements will help that corridor, that section of street. Those two blocks will be improved on the east side there. There will be
improved. It won't make a problem somewhere else down
there. No, sir. We'll make sure when we design it, that is, we do the hydraulic modeling and calculations, that we do not create something, a worse problem downstream. When we leave it, it will be better off. Any other questions before we move on? 2018.
Let me ask you another question.
Yes, sir.
Is all the problem there associated with the street itself, or is it with the lots as they what they said to drain?
We will be able to, with these improvements, control the water flow off the street. We'll make sure that they're not adversely affecting any of the property owners with these improvements. Some property owners will still have some challenges because their lots are below the road, and any rainfall that falls on their lots could potentially flow toward their houses. So we're taking care of the street, we're taking care of the right-of-way, but there are a couple property owners that potentially in heavy rainfalls could have some potential.
Still going to have a problem.
Have a little bit of ponding in their yard.
That problem, again, is not caused by the street.
That's correct.
It's caused by the grade of the lot.
And being below grade of the road, yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's quite evident if you ride there and look at it.
One of the old things when I was buying a house, my dad told me, don't buy below the road, son. You know, That's where it kind of comes from.
Doesn't shake that lot away from that house.
Is there a lot of gutters that run out to the street from the house, gutters? Is there a lot of gutter drains from the houses? I know I saw some out there. That's a lot of water.
Yeah, that adds to it, but if they, most time, when we do hydraulic calculations and people have got gutter drains there, we can capture that water and take it on away if they can get it to the street ditch system or curb and gutter or storm drainage system. Yes, we can handle that water.
Yeah, there's some on Yates Place I know that come out at the curb.
Yes, yeah. There's one on a rental I get caught on a regular basis. There's a water leak, and and they tell me the address.
Coming out down here, it's like it's all gone.
Okay. All right. As part of the 18 proposed funding schedule, we are looking to finance the construction of Yates Place Phase 2 at $355,000. So you see that construction price. It does have a CIP of 15% from the previous year. Shows the finance payment of $76,600. It shows the purchase of a stormwater camera, pole camera. It's not a camera. And then we have a little bit of funds for capital reserve for future years for stormwater. Balancing total expenditures of $463,000. And the financing, you'll see it's done for 5 years. Bobby's helped me with a projected rate of 2.5%, and the payment for 5 years is a level payment of $76,600. Any questions? 2019. Of course, we're continuing over the next 5 years to be the second year of the payment for Yates Place Phase 2 construction. We're then taking excess of the stormwater fees to create a capital reserve, bringing your capital reserve at the end of 2019 to $44,800. One of the things I think I maybe mentioned to Tell back in 2017, part of the operating budget for 2017, we're asking you to fund a preliminary engineering report for West Sycamore Street for some drainage issues we're having over there behind the auto zone and next to the church, Methodist Church property. We're building this reserve here to hopefully be able to address some of the recommendations that come out of the preliminary engineering report for West Sycamore Street. Any questions? 2020. Same thing again, pretty much the same as 19. For 20, we're continuing to build that capital reserve, and now that capital reserve is up to $76,200. Revenue and expenditures are balanced. 2021, we're basically making the fourth year of the payment for Yates Place construction at $76,600. We're hoping, not knowing what the report is, for West Sycamore Street, but we feel at this point in time we'll have about $107,000 in capital reserve to be able to address any potential issues over there that come up in that report and stuff. Yeah, well, clearly we can look to address some other issues for stormwater infrastructure. Any questions?
The Yates Place financing, how many years is that?
5 years.
5 year total?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Great. Any clarification, kind of like previously, is anything else you want to talk about? Other projects that you're concerned about and would like us to address? And as always, if you have a question later on, if you'll share it with Joe, we'll get you to answer and get you some feedback. And we, again, tonight, appreciate your time.
Thank you, Chris.
Your turn.
I bet. So on the 18th, we will go into the details of the street presentation, downtown, and the fleet. You've raised some good questions here that I wanted us to provide you some detail on. Is there any additional detail that we can bring to you on the 18th that you'd like some more detail on?
I am interested in the statement that was in the newspaper, and I just don't understand it, that in a revenue neutral formula, if we have the taxes we have today, we would be making less money. And I have done some calculations on my own with regards just to last year's valuation versus projected valuation, and I can't make that work out, so I don't understand. There must be some magic there.
There's definitely a lot of magic there. Could you repeat it, though, so I'm...
Well, let me give you an example. If you say that 15-16 valuation is $859 million, and the valuation for 16-17 is projected to be $923 million, then if you multiply those out at the current tax rate and subtract last year or the current year from the next year projected, you come up with a surplus of $336,000. And I cross-checked it another way and came up with the same number. So I don't understand why we would be having less revenue at the same tax rate under the revenue if we tried to go to the revenue neutral. Because if you take that 336 and calculate that out, say just divide it by 80,000, it's going to tell you the excess that you have, or what taxes, how many cents on the tax rate is there. So 80 into 336, whatever that is. I'm just having a hard time with those numbers, because it appears to me that with reevaluation, we're picking up a considerable amount of money.
Okay. Why don't we talk after the meeting so I can follow through on your
example?
I'll
be glad to. I just wanted to get it on the table. And okay. I mean, somebody else may have done the same math that I did, and I don't want to walk around mystified about it. I want to understand what's going on. I know the chief would like to have it.
Is he awake?
He's
awake?
Yeah, he's nodding his head. I woke him up.
Because I know I probably put him to sleep.
No, it is. It's just a question.
Sure. Yeah. Any other questions we can bring back to the board next week? Okay, hearing none, Lisa has some resolutions for you all to consider.
If we're going to take and have the public hearing, and we want to have our massaged budget, if you will we be able to get that accomplished by that date, or do we need to set the public hearing for another later date, or do we just wait until next week and determine where we are in the process?
All right. If we wait till next week, you can't have a public hearing on June 6th.
Okay.
You won't have enough time. I think you all will have to make that decision now about what's most important, about have the massage budget or bring the staff recommended budget.
Right.
I don't have a concern bringing our budget forward, allowing the public to comment on it, and if you all are not comfortable with it, then roll it into a work session. But that's just me. You all are really, that's what you're being asked right now. If you feel comfortable knowing that possibly you might not be able to resolve everything next week, and that you would bring forward a budget at a public hearing that is staff's recommendation and not the board's recommendation.
And you and I've had this talk, and I'm just concerned that we're going in for a public hearing when they don't really know what we're proposing. I mean, to me it's fairly obvious that this budget's going to take some work. And I hate to put it out there to the public that this is what we propose as the budget, when in fact it's not. Now, this board may feel different. I just have that concern. I think they should know what we really think the budget is.
Well, hopefully we get some feedback from our public hearing, hopefully.
Well, yeah, and that would carry forward from what we propose, in my opinion.
I hope they have questions.
Well, I hope they do too. I, you know, I don't know. Joe and I've had this discussion, so whatever you want to do is fine. I just really hate to put forth a budget that we know is not the final proposed budget. Yeah, and that's what we'd be doing, I think, if we put staff budget to the public hearing. What do y'all think?
I hate to put out there, and I don't really want to use the word inflated budget. I'm just afraid that we might catch a considerable amount of flack from the proposed budget by staff without a whole lot of our input.
Well, that was the intended strategy, to see that the community does or maybe does not give a comment on the recommended budget.
Beverly, let me correct it. I'm hearing what I'm hearing. You'd rather see our proposal.
Our proposal.
And I'm hearing that from Curtis, mm-hmm. Beverly.
Well, I think we probably do need to look at our changes and see what we want to do. Okay.
Glenn?
Yeah.
I don't know. Dale? I know, but I want to know what you think.
That's fine. Yeah.
Okay. Now, in order to do that, we need to know if we're going to be to that point in time.
Well, we've got time to,
we could insert another special meeting. I hate to do that, but we might want to go ahead and.
Yeah, as important as this budget's going to be, because it's different than what we've done, if it takes us further into June to get this thing decided, that's fine with me.
And me as well. I'd rather get it right than rush through it. Well, why don't we, you said that the second alternative is the work session, June's work session for the budget, public hearing.
How much time?
That's going to push. If we have to have some more meetings, I'm all for that. I'm fine. I just want to get it right. What I'm trying to do is make it work. But what I'm afraid of is that once we meet next week, that's when, we need to start massaging it, if in fact we're going to massage it, and I sense that we probably will, and I think you probably do too, but we need to be able to meet and do that if we're going to present our budget to the public for their comment.
If your preference is to not have a public hearing until you feel comfortable with the budget, then you just don't pass this resolution. Just know that you're going to have a public hearing sometime, and you got to be conscientious of the lead time to get the correct amount of to meet the advertising window, and just make sure you don't run up against, put yourself into a corner where you're not adopting a budget before the end of June.
I understand that, Joe, and we've been there before. I mean, this is not new territory, but we could, in fact, call for the public hearing on the 22nd.
But any budget we come up with, there's going to be people that don't agree with whatever we got. So it's hyper one different,
Well, I mean, we've had budget meetings where nobody even showed up,
Willie Brandon.
What I was going to say, and then I remember what you said. What I was going to say is, why don't we just wait until the 18th to establish and see how we are in the process. I don't know that we're going to be ready by that first meeting. And I don't know is the operative word. We might, but we're going to have to really push to do it.
But then to be safe, then you need to just go ahead and set it for June 27th, don't you think?
You can be safe that way. And then that gives us a week to work on it after we get public comment.
Best thing to do.
Well, if that is the case, then we don't have to adopt this resolution tonight. We can do it next week.
And, I could go ahead and present this budget that we've got here as far as what it is.
Well, the general consensus is that we present our budget. Why don't we just put this on next week's agenda, Joe?
Okay.
And we may, I don't know, we'll just see what we figure out.
All right.
Okay. Lisa, the second resolution.
The second resolution is a resolution calling for a public hearing on June 13th for the planning board and for commissioners to meet.
Okay. So that's resolution 2016-10. Is there a motion?
2016-12.
Oh, I'm sorry. I glanced at the wrong one. I'm in a hurry, I guess. 2016-12. Is there a motion?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
All in favor? And the motion carries. All righty. Thank you, folks. Joe?
That's all we have on our end. Thank you.
Okay, it's interesting, and I appreciate, again, all the effort being put forth by everyone, board and staff. Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
And a second.
Second.